You Were Perfectly Fine by Dorothy Parker. The pale young man eased himself carefully into the low chair and rolled his head to the side so that the cool chintz comforted his cheek and temple. "Oh, dear," he said. "Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. Oh." The clear-eyed girl, sitting light and erect on the couch, smiled brightly at him.
"Not feeling so well today?"
she said. "Oh, I'm great," he said. "Corking, I am. Know what time I got up? 4 o'clock this afternoon. Sharp. I kept trying to make it, and every time I took my head off the pillow, it would roll under the bed. This isn't my head that I've got on now. I think this is something that used to belong to Walt Whitman. Oh, dear. Oh, dear, oh, dear."
"Do you think maybe a drink will make you feel better?"
she said. "The hair of the mastiff that bit me," he said. "Oh, no, thank you. Please never speak of anything like that again. I'm through. I'm all through. Look at that hand, steady as a hummingbird. Tell me, was I very terrible last night?"
"Oh, goodness," she said. "Everybody was feeling pretty high. You were all right."
"Yeah," he said. "I must have been dandy. Is everybody sore at me?"
"Good heavens, no,"
she said.
"Everyone thought you were terribly funny. Of course, Jim Pearson was a little stuffy there for a minute at dinner, but people sort of held him back in his chair and got him calmed down. I don't think anybody at the other tables noticed at all. Hardly anybody."
"He was going to sock me," he said. "Good Lord, what did I do to him?"
"Why, you didn't do a thing,"
she said.
"You were perfectly fine. But you know how silly Jim gets when he thinks anybody is making too much fuss over Eleanor."
"Was I making a pass at Eleanor?" he said. "Did I do that?"
"Of course you didn't,"
she said.
"You were only fooling, that's all. She thought you were awfully amusing. She was having a marvellous time. She only got a tiny bit annoyed just once, when you poured the clam juice down her back."
"My God," he said, "the clam juice down that back. And every vertebrae a little cabot. What'll I ever do?"
"Oh, she'll be all right,"
she said.
"Just send her some flowers or something. Don't worry about it. It isn't anything."
"No, I won't worry," he said. "I haven't got a care in the world. I'm sitting pretty. Oh, dear, oh, dear. Did I do any other fascinating tricks at dinner?"
"You were fine," she said. "Don't be so foolish about it. Everybody was crazy about you. The owner was a little worried because you wouldn't stop singing, but he really didn't mind. All he said was he was afraid they'd close the place again if there was so much noise. But he didn't care a bit himself."
"I think he loved seeing you were having such a good time."
"Oh, you were singing away there for about an hour. It wasn't so terribly loud at all."
"So I sang," he said. "That must have been a treat. I sang."
"Don't you remember?" she said. "You sang one song after another. Everybody in the place was listening. They loved it. Only you kept insisting that you wanted to sing some song about some kind of fusiliers or other. And everybody kept shushing you, and you keep trying to start it again. You were wonderful. We were all trying to make you stop singing for a minute and eat something, but you wouldn't hear of it. My, you were funny."
"Didn't I eat any dinner?" he said.
"Oh, not a thing," she said. "Every time the waiter would offer you something, you'd give it right back to him because you said he was your long-lost brother, changed in the cradle by a gypsy band, and that anything you had was his. You had him simply roaring at you."
"I bet I did," he said. "I bet I was comical. Society's pet I must have been. What happened then, after my overwhelming success with the waiter?"
"Why, nothing much," she said. "You took a sort of dislike to some old man with white hair, sitting across the room, because you didn't like his necktie, and you wanted to tell him about it. But we got you out before he got really mad.
Oh, we got out, he said. Did I walk?
Walk? Of course you did, she said. You were absolutely all right. There was that nasty stretch of ice on the sidewalk, and you did sit down awfully hard, you poor dear. But good heavens, that might have happened to anybody.
Oh, sure, he said. Louisa Alcott or anybody. So I fell down on the sidewalk. That would explain the matter with my... yes, I see. And then what, if you don't mind?
Ah, now, Peter, she said. You can't sit there and say you don't remember what happened after that. I did think maybe you were just a little tight at dinner, but, oh, you were perfectly all right, and all that. But I did know you were feeling pretty gay. But you were so serious from the time you fell down. I never knew you to be that way. Don't you know how you told me I had never seen your real self before?
Oh, Peter, I just couldn't bear it. If you didn't remember that lovely long ride we took together in the taxi. Please, you do remember that, don't you? It would simply kill me if you didn't. Oh, yes, he said. Riding in the taxi. Oh, yes, sure. Pretty long ride, hmm?
Round and round the park, she said. Oh, and the trees were shining in the moonlight. And you said you never knew before that you really had a soul.
Yes, he said. I said that. That was me.
You said such lovely things, she said. And I'd never known all this time how you'd been feeling about me. And I'd never dared to let you see how I felt about you. And then, last night, oh,
Peter, dear, I think the taxi ride was the most important thing that ever happened to us in our lives.
Yes, he said. I guess it must have been.
And we're going to be so happy, she said. Oh, I just want to tell everybody.
But I don't know. I think maybe it would be sweeter to keep it all to ourselves.
I think it would be, he said.
Isn't it lovely, she said.
Yes, he said. Great.
Lovely, she said.
Look here, he said. Do you mind if I have a drink? I mean, just medicinally, you know. I'm off the stuff for life, so help me, when I think I feel a collapse coming on.
Oh, I think it would do you good, she said, you poor boy. It's a shame you feel so awful. I'll go make you a whiskey and soda.
Honestly, he said, I don't know how you could ever want to speak to me again after I made such a fool of myself last night. I think I'd better go and join a monastery in Tibet.
You crazy idiot, she said. As if I could ever let you go away now. Stop talking like that. You were perfectly fine.
She jumped up from the couch, kissed him quickly on the forehead, and ran out of the room. The pale young man looked after her and shook his head long and slowly,
then dropped it in his damp and trembling hands.
Oh, dear, he said. Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear.